Presbyterian Church. On this third Sunday of Advent, we yearn for... Wow. Yeah, do we need to do a little gospel aerobics this morning and, you know, that kind of thing? All right. I do want to hear a little bit of joy in your voices, because even if yesterday was a hard day and tomorrow you're not looking forward to because there's some hard things going on tomorrow, today we've got a bunch of young children, young and not young, young children, and then a few teenagers, thank you teenagers, and young adults, who are helping with the sermon today. Therefore, I don't even have to get in my robe. I can just be in my one and only Christmas sweater. So, on this third Sunday of Advent, we yearn for
joy.
So much better. I heard joy in all of that. This is the Sunday where our children and young people get to share the good news of Jesus Christ with you. And so they are going to be sharing a play called The Symbols of Christmas. And we've got our young people, and we've got three of our college, high school young people helping out, Wren and Hunt and Jack. So we thank them for being a part of this, as well as all of our kids. In the back of your bulletin are all the things going on in the life of our congregation this week. So take a look. It's always a very, it's just full of lots of wonderful things going on in ministries here at the church. We also have another pamphlet about the joy offering, which helps support our colleges and Presbyterian related colleges and our retired ministers, some of whom have been missionaries, and it's just a way to support that external vision of the church to be in this world with God's love. So you can read more about where that offering goes. On the end of our pews are these booklets. I don't quite know what to call them, friendship pads. And we would like to know that you're here. And if you would like to share your contact information, if you think we don't have it, that would be great, too. We also have prayer cards. They're either yellow or green. And if you have a prayer to share that you would rather write down instead of share out loud, because we do that, just write that down and put it in the offering plate, and we'll include it in our prayer time later on. Are there any other announcements? Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Please remain seated and open your hymnals to number 85, and let us sing the third verse of Light One Candle to Watch for Messiah.
Thank you.
We are the people yearning for joy.
We see joy in the eyes of children, and we celebrate their joy.
And we celebrate the joy of the birth of Jesus.
We now light the candle of joy.
Please stand in body or spirit and let us sing our opening hymn, Angels We Have Heard on High, which is number 113 in your hymnal.
Be seated. Whenever we gather for worship, we gather knowing that the previous week has been one of maybe a lot of joy, but maybe some struggles. Maybe we have been at our best. Sometimes we perhaps haven't been at our best. And when we gather on Sunday, we take all of that and we bring it to God, seeking reconciliation and restoration in our relationship with God and with each other. So we take time to confess those separations. So I invite you now to be in silent personal confession, and then I will invite us to pray together. Let us pray. And let us pray together. God of risk takers, God who is waiting for our yes, may we be as open to your blessings as Mary. May we be as welcoming to our Lord as Elizabeth. May we be as steadfast as Joseph and sing like Zechariah. May we welcome your intrusion in our lives, even when it comes in the form of angels disguised as strangers. May our souls respond with joy as we work to lift up the lowly, feed the hungry, shelter the homeless, and comfort the hurting. For we do it all in the name of your Son. Amen. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. May the peace of Christ be with you. Let us pass the peace of Christ to each other. Reunions that are going on because we have kids home from college, which is great. I'm going to ask the children to start coming up front so we can begin our play in just a moment. Yeah, welcome home to our college kids. It's great to see you. Some of you are meeting for the first time because you've been at college. So I'd like to have the children come up and take your places, but I'm going to need maybe four of the younger ones or the little ones to help me bring out this week's tablecloth, because we're not having communion during Advent. We're yearning for it as we've been yearning for hope and love and joy and peace. And the kids have been helping me lay a new tablecloth on the communion table. It gets lighter each Sunday as we move toward the light of Christ. And then we add another piece of the table setting. So right now, as you guys remember, we put out the pitcher on the first Sunday of Advent, and we put out the chalice last week. So what do you think is next? Anybody know? So we've got all the stuff for the when we have the juice or the wine, but what are we missing? Bread. So that means we need a plate. All right. So let's have some of the little kids come and help me bring out the tablecloth. And if two of you big kids would come and just take this off the table and hold it up while we bring out our new tablecloth. So let's go. One more thing before we start our play is what we do every Sunday. Let's wave at our online worshipers. Hi, online worshipers. And then don't forget that camera. Hi, online worshipers. And then again, that camera seems to always be pointed at Sarah, so Sarah can wave, but we can wave too. Hi, online worshipers. All right, let's get started.
Is yours on?
Christmas?
I love getting ready for Christmas.
It's my favorite time of the year.
It makes me get in the mood for Christmas.
Yeah, I guess.
This stuff just fills up the house and gets in my way.
I'm so glad you're excited about it. But you have to remember that this stuff really means something.
What do you mean?
Why do we celebrate Christmas?
It's Jesus' birthday.
It's when we remember that he came into this world as a baby.
That's right.
Why do we have to decorate then?
Yeah, why do we have to fill up our house with all this stuff?
Let's talk about this stuff and what it all really means. Starting with the evergreen tree.
An evergreen tree has a very appropriate name. It is evergreen, always green. It does not become dormant in the winter as other trees do. The color green represents new life, and the needles of the evergreen always point up, heavenward. It symbolizes our everlasting life with Jesus Christ. We should be as the evergreen tree, always full of life, never becoming dormant in our life with Christ as our arms are lifted heavenward. The bread of God is the one who comes down from heaven. He gives life to the world. John 6:33.
I didn't realize.
Wow, I didn't either.
I just thought it was a tree.
Yeah, I didn't know it meant something.
What does all this other stuff mean?
Well, how about the ornaments?
Ornaments are used to decorate the Christmas tree each and every year. People look for the perfect ones to fit on their tree. Our Christmas tree just wouldn't seem incomplete without ornaments. Ornaments can symbolize the blessings in our lives. Our lives just wouldn't be complete without God's blessings. Everything that we have is due to God loving us so much that he wants to shower us with his blessings. Just as ornaments are all different shapes and sizes, blessings are all different as well. God picks and chooses each blessing for us so that it will be just right. Next time you decorate your tree, and as you put each ornament up, thank the blessings that God has given you. I think you'll find you'll run out of ornaments before you run out of blessings. Every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord, your God, and what he has given you. Deuteronomy 16:17.
Blessings.
We have so many blessings.
We have our home and our family.
Think of all the blessings that God has given us.
Okay, so I guess it's not so bad, and it does look nice.
Oh, and there's so much more. How about the lights and the candles?
Lights and candles are used to give light. When a room is full of darkness, it is dark. But if you light a single match in a dark room, the room is light. There may be more darkness, but the light overpowers it. We are the light. We can be the single light in the world of darkness. We must share our light with the world so that light increases. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand. And it gives light to all in the house. Matthew 5:14-15.
I love the lights. They're so pretty.
Let's put more lights on.
I never knew.
I guess I never looked at it that we are the lights for God.
Exactly right. Let's put the bells on the tree next.
The bell rings out to guide the lost sheep back to the fold, signifying that we are all precious in the eyes of the Lord. Jesus is our shepherd, and he laid down his life for us so that we may spend eternity with him in heaven. He is calling us to follow him through his word. Are you going to listen? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountain and go in search of the one that went astray? Matthew 18:12. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. John 10:11.
The bells sound so beautiful.
I just love to listen to them.
Jesus is our shepherd.
We are his sheep.
He would go looking for me.
Who likes candy canes?
Me.
These aren't to eat. These go on the tree.
The candy cane symbolizes multiple things. If you hold it upright, it looks like a shepherd's crook. The shepherds were some of the first people who were able to see the baby Jesus in Bethlehem. If you turn the candy cane upside down, it looks like a J. Jesus starts with the letter J. The colors of the candy cane are also symbolic. The red represents the blood that Jesus shed for us on the cross, and the white represents the purity of Jesus. There are candy canes with three red stripes running around it. These stripes symbolize the Trinity, God the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Who knew that this delicious candy was so simply, profoundly symbolic of our Lord Jesus Christ in his simple birth? And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Matthew 1:21.
These are delicious.
I love this part of Christmas.
It means so many things.
There seems to be a reason why we do everything that we do.
I can see now how this stuff has meaning.
I'm really glad you're changing your mind. We have stars to put on the tree next.
The star is a heavenly sign of prophecy fulfilled ages ago, the shining hope for all mankind. The star led the wise men to find the baby Jesus. These wise men traveled many miles following a star in the sky. The star was their guiding light to the Savior. God was these wise men's traveler, leading them to the greatest destination known to man, the Savior. We now have his word as our guiding light to lead us to be with him in heaven. Are you going to follow? And behold, the star, which they had seen in the east, went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. Matthew 2:9-10.
I like that the star was their guiding light.
They were able to follow the star to Jesus.
That must have been an amazing journey.
I'm glad we have the Bible now to help lead us.
Yes, God's word leads us to Jesus.
Our tree is almost finished. We just have to put the angel on top.
Imagine, you are a lowly shepherd watching over your sheep. This night seems no different than any other. Then all of a sudden, an angel of the Lord is in the sky above you, telling you of the Savior's birth. You, a shepherd? Why did God send an angel to tell the shepherds? Because the message that God has about the birth of Jesus was for all people, not just for the right, not just for the Jews, everyone. God chose his number one messenger to tell the lowest of people of his son's birth. God looks at the heart, not at what the world looks at. Thank goodness. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them and looks at the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were so afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Luke 2:9-11.
Our tree looks beautiful.
I wouldn't change anything.
The angel was like a messenger of God.
The angel told the good news of Jesus' birth.
Wow, I didn't know. But what about all the other stuff that we put around our house?
Let's talk about the holly that we're going to put on the table.
We see holly as decorations during the Christmas season, but do we really understand what holly stands for? The leaves represent the crown of thorns that are placed upon Jesus' head as he was being crucified. The berries symbolize the blood that he shed for us. He endured criticism, excruciating pain and embarrassment, all for you and me. The next time you decorate something with holly on it, remember what was done so that he could spend an eternity with you. I know I will. In twisting together a crown of thorns, they put on his head and a reed in his right hand. In kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews. Matthew 27:29.
That's amazing what he did for us.
It makes me feel blessed to know him.
He went all through all of that for me.
He came to this earth to die for me and you.
That's quite an amazing thing to think about during this Christmas season.
That leads us to the wreaths between the windows.
The wreath has its evergreen branches bent in a circle so that the ends touch, having no beginning or end, just as there's no beginning or end of Jesus' eternal love for us. Just as the wreath looks the same throughout the year and seems not to change, so he will always be the same. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, and the same today, and forever. Hebrews 13:8.
I just love how it looks on our door.
Yes, it really finishes off the look of the room.
It's nice to know he will never change.
I didn't realize it had a meaning.
That's a great reminder that even though we change and grow, he'll always be right there. Now what about the presents? Those can't have a meaning.
Then you would be surprised.
These days, the world has forgotten the reason for Christmas. Most people seem to think getting presents is the greatest thing about Christmas. Other people seem to think that presents have nothing to do with Christmas. Well, they're both wrong. The wise men came to visit Jesus as a young child, and they gave him presents. They gave him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They offered him gold as a king, paying him tribute, frankincense as a god, for they honored God with smokes of incense. And myrrh, as a man that should die, for myrrh was used for embalming dead bodies. These wise men, saw this child and knew that he is a king, is a god, and that he would die for the sins of this world. How can anyone, with the knowledge that we now have, not believe? The wise men went to the house. There they saw the child with his mother Mary. They bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures. They gave him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Matthew 2:11.
I love to get presents.
I didn't know that's the reason we give gifts.
But Jesus is really the greatest gift to us all.
He truly is.
I never knew that the wise men's gifts had meaning. What about the wrapping? That's just something we came up with, right?
Yes and no. The bows and ribbons really have a special meaning that we should remember.
Many people spend hours wrapping all their Christmas presents during Christmas time. They use ribbons, garland, and bows to make sure their presents are as beautiful as possible. What they don't realize is that the item that they use to complete the outside of the gift has more meaning than the actual gift inside. The bow ties are present with beautiful ribbon, just as Jesus ties us as Christians together in his love. We may not be in the same family, but we are all in God's family. We Jesus is the ribbon that binds us together. Above and above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Colossians 3:14.
I just thought the wrappings were to hide the present inside.
Yeah, I never thought about them having their own meaning.
There's really a lot to think about.
I guess I'll have to look at things differently.
That's for sure. I never knew all this stuff had meaning.
People do get a little crazy with all the stuff of Christmas. The parties, the presents, the busyness. What we should do is to slow down and really enjoy the true meaning of Christmas. Now, who wants a cookie?
I know there's not a meaning in the cookie.
Making cookies is a favorite pastime for most families during the Christmas season. Cookie cutters are used to turn ordinary dough into edible masterpieces. God doesn't use cookie cutters when he creates each one of us. He makes us and each and every one of us so special and unique that he would have to break the mold after just one use. He is the potter and we are his clay. He wants to mold us into his masterpieces. We only need to be moldable and willing to follow his lead. Behold, like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. Jeremiah 18:6.
Thank you.
God, you blessed us so much this morning as the children of our church have been able to share with us that they understand how much you love them and how much you love all of us. We give these gifts in response, in thanksgiving, to your generosity, and we pray that your Holy Spirit will continue to guide us in how we use these gifts. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Now is the time that we collect your prayers, and the way we do that is I'll read the prayers that have been sent up here, but also from the back to the front. If you have a prayer you want to share out loud, these are both prayer joys and prayer concerns and prayer wonderings. Prayers as I make my way back. Randy.
A friend of mine, Rusty Arrington, had a significant heart attack about 3 weeks ago. He survived, and they were able to get a stent into his blocked artery, but he's got a long haul to recovery. So prayers for Rusty, his wife, and his son.
Lord, in your mercy.
It's a dance. Yes. Prayer for Marco's cousin Randy Listrom. He's been diagnosed with cancer. He'll be going into surgery on the Thursday. So,
Lord, in your mercy.
Prayers for the Park Hill South Lady Panthers basketball team, who went to Phoenix this morning for a week-long tournament. We pray for their safety and well-being.
Lord, in your mercy.
My second, Donna Swanson, lost her battle to cancer, and they had her funeral yesterday. Prayers for the family and those who know her.
Our neighbor, Andy Dominguez, had brain surgery in New York, and they were not able to get it all, and they're trying to figure out a path forward. Yeah, a tumor. So keep him and the family in your prayers.
For both of those prayers, Lord, in your mercy.
Last Sunday, we asked prayers for Betty, who was suffering from cancer. She took her last breath in the evening of Sunday, last Sunday. Today we pray for Sue Singleton in Colorado, who is suffering from cancer also. I'm reminded of Sue up in St. Joe, and she was choir director, and EJ and I were in the choir, and we were singing this song at Christmas, Angels We Have Heard on High. And when we come to the Excelsis, she reminded us, just say eggshells. And it'll come out all right. So we did, and some of the congregation people said later, sounded like the choir was singing eggshells. So let us pray for Sue, who is suffering from cancer. She lives in Colorado.
Lord, in your mercy.
Yes.
I'd like to share a joy. Last night on Broadway was the opening night of a new musical called How to Dance in Ohio. And it is a musical put on by the autistic Broadway actors and musicians about autistic people and how they see, view, and experience the world. This is moving, it is groundbreaking. And for every family or anyone who knows of someone on the autistic spectrum, it's a real triumph. That's my joy.
Lord, in your mercy. We want to pray for the Collazo family from Venezuela, who visited us at the end of worship last week, and that they find the jobs and acquire a car as so that they can work, and many folk in our church have been so helpful to them. So that's a blessing. Lord, in your mercy. We want to pray for Chaplain San Sam Sanford and Sam's family. His funeral will be December 21st. He was an inspiration for so many. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, we wrap up all these prayers of joys and concerns, of eggshells and musicians who help us to learn to sing in different ways, folks who are going through difficult times, folks who have joined your church triumphant. We lift all those up now, knowing that there are places all over our world over which we continue to pray, whether it's Ukraine or Israel and Gaza, the rest of the Middle East, African nations. There are so many places in our world that are struggling, and yet we have hope that the Prince of Peace will continue to work in all of us, that we may bring peace and reconciliation and love. We're grateful that when we're not quite sure how to pray, you have given us this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'm going to invite my four young people who are going to help me with the charge and benediction forward. And I invite you to stand and let us sing Go Tell It on the Mountain.
Of Jesus Christ
and the joy of the Holy Spirit
be with all of you.
Amen.